I can't tell my mother. Like my mom, I can't die before my mom. I can't leave my daughter. Had to stop practicing, and I really felt adrift. Like, why am I using up oxygen on this planet? It was crazy because number one, I felt stupid. I'm a physician. I should know about that 25 to 35% of people with an early stage, especially hormone receptor positive diagnosis, will eventually become metastatic. And I was like, what? Like, I'm 5 years out, I should be cured. It really hit me hard. If you're treated by a community oncologist who might be seeing a patient with lung cancer at 9 and, you know, 3 breast cancer patients in a row at, you know, 10, starting at 10, but 2 of them are early stage, they might have 1 or 2 people with metastatic breast cancer in their whole practice, and they're doing everything, lung, colon, you know, blood cancers. They're not going to be up to date on what is happening.
For more than 20 years, we thought that HER2 was either positive or negative. And positive was about 20% of the tumors that were very aggressive, that needed to be treated with chemotherapy, with many agents against HER2. The other 80% was treated very differently. But what happened is that in that 80%, we knew that even if we called it negative, there was some HER2, just not enough to call it positive. So nowadays, more than half of all patients with breast cancer are called HER2 low because they have an expression of 1+ or 2+ non-amplified. And what was impressive to see at ASCO is that in this very large population of patients, delivering chemotherapy with this new class of drugs that we call antibody drug conjugates, and with a drug in particular that is called, with a very long complex name, trastuzumab deruxtecan, for friends, TDXD, or NR2, the commercial name, was very effective, much more effective than traditional chemotherapy. And so this drug has been approved in August 5th and is now available, and we use it to treat many patients with metastatic breast cancer. And the impact has been very large, not only because this has improved the shrinkage or the duration of the response, but also the survival of patients with metastatic breast cancer.
You know, HER2 was originally the cancer that, oh my God, HER2 is so aggressive, and you know, people just don't do as well. And then, you know, Herceptin came along, and then Perjeta came along, and now these new things called antibody drug conjugates that are, and they have made a huge difference to the point where those of us that have ER positive disease are going, God, I wish I was HER2 positive, because there's so many more options and things that are working really, really well. But again, I think what we're learning in some of the data from these trials looking at HER2 low is if you have a really high level of HER2, you know, you're HER2 positive, HER2 3+, the drug's going to work really, you know, for a lot of people, it's going to work really, really well. If it's 2+, it's still going to work well, but maybe not quite as well. And then 1+ and 0, but there even might be some efficacy. It might work in even people who have no HER2 overexpression. Okay.
The thing is that in this setting, metastatic breast cancer, we really need options, because so many times patients run out of treatment options. We use all the most effective treatments that we have, endocrine treatment, taxanes, capecitabine, biologic agents, anthracyclines. And in the end, we really don't have any more effective options. Sometimes we have to recycle chemotherapies. And in this setting, we really would like to use a drug that has proven to be efficacious and even to improve survival in HER2-low patients.
And I think one of the things that's important for patients to know is that you can look back on biopsies from maybe your original breast cancer diagnosis, or if you were diagnosed with mets from the get-go, de novo metastatic disease, if you had a biopsy, that can be looked at to see, okay, do I have a little bit of HER2? Do I have none at all? And then that opens up this whole avenue of these new antibody drug conjugates as a treatment option. And I think that's really exciting because, you know, the more options we have, the better.
The talk that I'm giving today is part of a panel on patient report outcomes, which are opportunities for patients to describe how they're feeling, what symptoms they're experiencing, what psychosocial challenges they might have that might prevent them from optimizing their breast cancer journey. There is diversity across different communities. So, you know, many of the Black women who aren't participating in clinical trials, it's not necessarily that they need more socioeconomic help. It's that they need to have faith in a healthcare system that has let down Black people for generations. And so many of the women who choose not to participate in clinical trials who are African American, it's not because they can't afford to do so. It's that they have a justified mistrust in the system, a system that has not earned the trustworthiness of people of color. And so I think that descriptions of trial results matter. Words matter.
I just had a conversation today that some of these trials cost $1 billion with a B dollars. And if you don't have advocates involved early to make sure your design is going to be palatable to patients, that the questions you're asking make sense to provide treatments to make lives not only longer but better, you're wasting time, you're wasting money, you're wasting lives. You're an advocate. You're an advocate for yourself. If you were that, you know, PTA mom that, you know, raised the money through the bake sales to get a new playground for your kid's school, well, you'd be great at fundraising for support groups, for research, et cetera. If you're that person that goes to the city council meetings and is going, why are you putting a stop sign here? Then maybe legislative advocacy, you know, trying to get bills passed locally or nationally to help benefit the metastatic community is your place, but everybody has a place and everybody has a role.